Right? Thank you very much for coming this evening. I'm going to start, because I hate ingratitude, I'm going to start with a few words of gratitude to Tom Tam, to all of you, by the way, for coming this evening, but mainly to Ari and its predecessor, Ahek. I'm a scholar who's sort of, I guess, in the middle years at this point. I've published about 13 books. The first time anybody, any organization, ever supported my scholarly work was Ari. The very first time. And I don't want to go off into some condemnation of my university or of my college or the other organizations that, you know, I've applied to for various grants, etc. But the first time I ever said, I need a little support, a little, in this particular case, it was the research grants that you so generously gave. But mainly, it's not the research grant, as you know, Tom. It's the support for someone who has an idea and wants to pursue it. And I don't know what it is, I don't know what's wrong these days, but there are not that many organizations that do support scholars such as myself. And I am very, very grateful to this organization. I think that Tom Tam is doing an amazing job here. I think these Friday evening consortia, colloquia, are fascinating. I've come to a few of them in the past, and I was dying to give my own. And now for a few words about this evening's program. I beg your indulgence on this evening's program and patience as well. This is a work in progress. This is not a finished piece of research. This is not a book. The type of book, Tom, you mentioned this book, actually. The type of book this will someday become, give me 2 years, three, is this, which is, this is called The Saints of Modern Art, which Tom so generously mentioned. I don't know anybody who's doing this kind of work, and I understand why. This is an interdisciplinary book. It takes an idea, and it pursues it through painting, sculpture, architecture, music, dance, literature, and philosophy. Now, the reason why you've got all this stuff up here, and the reason why these two guys are going crazy right now, is that what I would like to do this evening is take an idea and pursue it through different disciplines. And maybe one of the reasons why my college and some organizations don't quite know what to do with my research proposals is that I do rather enjoy this interdisciplinary approach to a subject where you know, specialists would say, let's talk about Chinese calligraphy. Let's talk about it in historical terms. Let's talk about a review of the literature. Let's take a few pieces and critically examine them. And I love books like that, and I think they're extremely important. But there's a place, I think, I hope, for another type of book, a book like this, that says, let's talk about an idea. In this particular case, the virtuoso. What does the virtuoso mean, not just in Chinese calligraphy and painting, but in other fields, such as art, or music, or literature, or dance, or architecture, or you name it. And in a certain way, this is one of these sort of questions that I sometimes like to ask my dinner party guests. I know what a virtuoso is in art, for instance. If you give the next couple of slides. Well, I know what a virtuoso is in music. This is the piano of Franz Liszt. Now, Franz Liszt, this poor piano, which was rediscovered recently, Franz Liszt, when he played the piano, would torture this thing. Do you know the stories of Liszt? You know Liszt, the Hungarian pianist? He would pound it so hard that the keys at the end would be broken, the strings would snap, the piano would literally start moving across the stage if it weren't locked down. He gave a concert once in London. The women in the front row were whoo, like this. But the people who owned the piano at the end of the concert were furious because he destroyed this instrument. With what? With power, with action, with this kind of outrageous, extreme behavior. He was the rock star. He was like a glam rock star of his day. And it was a type of music that he created, a virtuoso type of music, that had never, ever really been heard. I mean, there had been examples in the past. I suppose if I push a button over here, it's going to go Tchaikovsky, right? Do you know how to do this? All right. If there had been examples of this in the past, actually, and I have endeavored for this evening to play almost all Chinese soloists, by the way. This is Lang Lang playing Tchaikovsky, right? And it'll be, yeah, right here? It'd be more fun if I had a piano up here and I just banged at it. Volume, please. This is great. It's like an advertisement for a laptop. Just sort of picture, oh, too bad. Picture Long Long, who is a wonderful Chinese pianist, by the way, banging that, we used to call him Lao Chai when I lived in China. Lao Chai? Banging the Tchaikovsky across the piano like this, almost torturing the keys, and doing things, and here comes the definition of the virtuoso, doing things, don't worry about, doing things as Liszt would do, as Rachmaninoff would do, as Chopin would do, that nobody else could do, technically speaking. That's a virtuoso. You have the technique to do something at the piano as Liszt did. Let's take another slide just for fun. As Raphael did with his drawings. And by the way, I use a drawing here rather than a painting of by Raphael. And one of the reasons why is that I study a lot of art history. I'm very interested in art. You're going to hear a lot of art this evening. I'm more interested in what a Raphael would do with a pencil or a bit of charcoal, because I feel as though we get closer to the technique of a Raphael by looking at Raphael's drawings. Raphael in his own day, as in the Renaissance, was a virtuoso of pen and pencil and charcoal technique. And then you put a brush in his hands, and of course he was a virtuoso of brush technique. Let's go to the next slide. Dürer. Albrecht Dürer, German artist of a particular genius, early Renaissance. This, as you probably know, is a woodcut. This was not just drawn. This is not just a pencil drawing. This is actually Dürer taking a block of wood and going and carving it out. So that the virtuosity of this particular piece, this is one of the most famous woodblock prints in the whole world, is not simply that he could draw something that intricate, but that he could actually carve it. Keep this one in mind, if you would, when I get to the calligraphy later on and I start yakking away about Xi'an and the forest of stelae, because I want to talk about what happens when Chinese calligraphy is carved into stone. Let's go to the next slide. Here's Goltzius. This is another amazing example of printmaking. His name is Goltzius, G-O-L-T-Z-I-U-S. This is a particularly moving, emotional slide for me, because I happen to know that Goltzius put his right hand in the fire one day by accident, burned it, and permanently disabled himself. He was an artist who drew with his right hand, and obviously he's drawing his right hand with what? With his left hand. So in other words, he translated his virtuosity from his right hand to his left hand. This is another print. Those of you who have ever made prints, and she's made prints, my wife here. That's okay, stop. Those of you who have ever made prints know that is a very, very difficult technique. Now, talk about virtuosi. Here's a name you probably know as well. That's okay, just there. Here's a name you know very well, Vermeer, V-E-R-M-E-E-R. He's a Dutch artist of about the time of Rembrandt. He was considered to be the perfect painter, just as Raphael in the Italian Renaissance was the perfect painter. What was his virtuosity? His virtuosity would be, for instance, nobody could paint a texture like that brick or those windows the way Vermeer could do it. As a matter of fact, his nickname in those days, let's go to the next picture, was the Sphinx of Delft. You know Vermeer? You've seen perhaps the girl with pearl earring, right? And Vermeer, for instance, would say, and I always think of this as kind of the way in which a virtuoso would talk to you anyway. He'd say, nobody can do something like the reflection of the light on the silver, or the way in which I do the drapery, or the way in which I catch the light and set it against shadow. So as Liszt might say, nobody can play my octaves. And as other musicians would say, nobody could do this, or sing as high as this, or play as fast as this. Those of you who love ballet or the dance, dancers can be virtuosi too. A dancer who can go all the way quickly, quickly, quickly around within a few beats. A dancer like a Baryshnikov or a Nureyev who can jump higher. This is a virtuoso of dance. Let's go to the next slide then. This is de la Tour. Sometimes, I put this one in because my wife really loves these peaches. Sometimes you've got an artist who could just capture textures so perfectly. use color and paint in a way that just makes you taste the peach. That's virtuosity. I knew you'd like that one. And this is a totally different one, but this brings me exactly to the point I want to make tonight as we go on to Chinese calligraphy. This is Turner. This is the English artist Turner, 19th century. And one of the reasons why I want him in here early is many, many people, when they looked at Turner's in his time, would say, "What's that? What kind of mess is this? What are you trying to depict? What are you trying to tell us with a picture like this? Are you really that good a painter?" And Turner, of course, would come back and say, "You can only be me. You can only be a painter of my quality, a painter of my originality, if you destroy all the form in the service of, in this particular case, color." There's a boldness to a Turner. It reminds me of a very, very beautiful line. I have almost no notes to give you, but I have this one line from a German philosopher named Novalis. "Chaos shimmers through the veil of order." It's so good, I'm going to repeat it. "Chaos shimmers through the veil of order." Now, anyone in here who's an artist or a musician will understand that there cannot be art without order. You've got to have form and structure. Actually, you know this probably as teachers. You know this as computer guys as well. You know this almost in any field where you're a professional. You know this in film, Tom, I'm sure. Order is there, but then chaos shimmers through the veil of order. In other words, in a piece like this, in some of the music that I wanted to play, I mean, do you have the next? Try the next one. Play the Rachmaninoff for a second. Is that Rachmaninoff? Let me see. That one, yeah. Just play the beginning of that one. "Chaos shimmers through the veil of order" in a painting like this. The power of these paintings and the power of the music he's about to play comes from the idea that the order, the form, the structure could be broken at any moment and then restored again. Let's listen for a second to a very, very great example of a virtuoso performer who became a great composer. His name was Sergei Rachmaninoff. And this is truly one of the best examples I can give you, in addition to Liszt, of how this works. Nice and loud. That's the loudest. Quiet, please. You know the piece, I hope?
Yeah.
Go home and play it at the maximum volume when you go home. I apologize for the sound quality, but listen, that's the point. Rachmaninoff was this huge man. My father once saw him in Boston and said, "You have no idea how big his hands were. They were like bear paws." He'd come out to the piano and he'd sit down hunched over this thing. And he would do things at that piano that even Liszt could not do, simply because his hands were so big, because he could play more powerfully, he could play more quickly. And the curious thing about this, the thing that I want to really write a book about is this. Rachmaninoff would come on stage, and he was a performer. You following me? Maybe he would play his own work, maybe he would play a Mozart piece, he would play a Tchaikovsky piece. He would play for you a Tchaikovsky piece. He was interpreting Tchaikovsky. But because he was so good, so powerful, so innovative, because his hands were so big, all of a sudden what he could do is something that even Brahms hadn't thought about. And he could perhaps extend an octave, maybe he could put a trill in there. And then as soon as he, as you well know, those of you who have played music, you have the score, you have the music in front of you, and you play it. And then all of a sudden you get what's called a cadenza, and you're great, like Rachmaninoff, or Liszt, or Paderewski, you name your pianist. You can stop it now. Or you're great like, Horowitz was a great example of it, Yevgeny Kissin these days. You name your pianist that you like. Suddenly you say to yourself, "You know, I could play that faster. The metronome markings are thus, I could play it a little faster." You know who does this all the time? You go up to Juilliard, you listen outside the rehearsal rooms of Juilliard, and those kids are playing it faster, 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 louder, 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 pushing the limits, pushing it to the extremes. And suddenly I think this is what happens with a composer like Liszt or Rachmaninoff
or Tan Dun, a friend of ours, actually, who's also an extremely good pianist, but also somebody who could pick up an instrument and do things with it that nobody ever has ever done before. He says, why should I just be the performer every day and play the music of Lao Chai or Brahms? Why don't I take my incredible ability to play the piano and make something new out of this? Make a new type of music, make a new concerto, make a new sound out of this whole thing. And of course, that's a little bit like, in fact, I would say more than a little bit like, that's exactly what Turner was saying as well. Turner could paint a landscape, but then Turner could also paint something like this. A very, very good example in music, I hope this thing's gonna, is this gonna go into the VCR right away? A very, very good example in music, of course, is jazz.
When he agreed to appear at the Vendome movie theater,
we're talking about Louis Armstrong now.
He asked him to go on stage when he soloed. Armstrong refused to do it. He wouldn't leave the pit, he said, for fear of alienating the rest of the band. But they shone a spotlight down on him anyway. And when it found his gleaming horn,
now listen for a second to the music behind this.
Sometimes getting 50 high C's in a row.
You hear that?
As the crowd counted along with him, audiences went wild.
Listen to this.
And that's what you call a jumping dude. It was lined up for blast.
That's Louis Armstrong.
The guys who can say show every night and see if I'm going to miss that note.
Did you ever?
Why? I get
on the car. A promising young horn player from Nashville.
Yeah, we can pause it now. Listen, I don't understand Louis Armstrong when he speaks English either. What they were talking about there for a second was people would come to listen to him play and know that he was going to try to hit a certain high note. And they would count it as he would hit it, you know, that high, high C. And hear and listen to see if he would do it each time. I remember going to the ballet when Margot Fonteyn would do what is called a whip turn. And the audience would applaud when she got up to number 23, which was unreal that she could do 23. I also remember, I don't know if any of you ever did this, going up to Lincoln Center and listening to Luciano Pavarotti sing and hit those high notes, bum, bum, bum. Nine high C's in Donizetti's, I gotta remember the name of the opera, Fil de Regiment. Nine times he'd hit those high C's. And you'd sit there in the opera house going, will he do it? Two, three, everybody would count. Four, can he do it? And his chest would fill with air and he was this big, you know, he was this big, fat Luciano Pavarotti. Five, six, seven, he'd take the breath in, eight, he'd nail the ninth one, the place would go crazy, crazy, because he'd done something extreme. He'd taken you in art past, and of course the thing that I always love about a guy like Armstrong, you could pop that video out because we're going to put the next one in a second, a guy like Armstrong or Pavarotti or Turner here in painting is, it's awesome. It's there's no net underneath them. There was no, you know, it's not like Broadway or a movie. You know, I love movies, but sometimes I don't love movies where they can edit the sound and everything. If he missed the note, he missed the note, everybody. He was out there taking a risk. In the same way, let's take a look at some of the other slides. Here's John Singer Sargent, an American painter. I think he's probably one of the great virtuosi of the brush. Somebody who, for instance, in a watercolor like this, would take great risks, make wonderful flourishes, make things happen with paint that other artists can't make. Let's see what the next one is. And of course, who else but? Right? Who else but? Eventually, I was going to get to him. The great virtuoso of 20th century art, Picasso. Even when he was 9 years old, he could draw better than his father, who was an art teacher. And he had what other artists call the hand. Now, like Armstrong, when Picasso can do something like this, then eventually what he can do, and this is the part that I think could make this book kind of an interesting book about modern art. If you can play the trumpet so well,
And you could play probably anything that's put in front of you. Then eventually what you can also do is you can break the rhythm. You can break the melody. You can disguise the tune and do your own thing. Picasso, as you know, could paint and draw like this. Then eventually what does he do? He breaks the picture into cubism. One of the reasons why he could do it, frankly, is that he was so good technically. So if there's anything that you're going to learn tonight, for instance, about music and art and calligraphy and other areas that I'd like to talk about, is that first you must be technically brilliant, and then you can break the rules. You know what I mean? First, you must have technique. And the first sentence I want to have of my book, I have done some work on the book with the support of Ari. The first sentence is a really easy three-word sentence. Looking at, now we're moving along. Looking at something, that's all right. Looking at something like this. Technique mediates knowledge. Technique can take you to a level of knowledge of making that is higher if you have the technique. If you're a Picasso, if you're an Armstrong, if you're a Yo-Yo Ma, we'll get to him in a second, if you're a Paderewski, you can reach a level of musical knowledge, of painterly knowledge, that nobody's ever reached before. Let's go to the next slide. This, of course, is, as I was saying before to you, you can have this in almost any field, in any discipline. Here's a virtuoso of architecture. His name is Frank Lloyd Wright. The museum is the Guggenheim uptown. Wright said, I will, here's one of the big problems with it, of course. Wright said, I want this thing to be created almost like one continuous pour of concrete. The builders and the engineers said, what? Are you crazy? It can't be done. But Wright said, it will be done sort of like that. It will be done in my way. Strikingly original. Only original because Wright had this mastery of the material, concrete, by the way. I don't know, did anybody read that article a few months back about the Japanese architect Taniguchi as he was doing MoMA? And he said, those bloody American builders, they don't know how to do concrete well enough to do my buildings. Wright understood concrete. He knew that he could make one continuous pour. He could make a metaphor into a building. Wow! What an amazing, audacious, bold thought. What a perfect example of chaos shimmering through the veil of order. Because you know what the chaos is? You probably already know if you know anything about Frank Lloyd Wright. The buildings would leak when the rain came down. The engineering problems were huge. He was breaking the forms. He was doing things that nobody had ever done before in architecture because he was a virtuoso. The only one who's come close to him has actually designed museums for the Guggenheim. Next slide. Frank Gehry. A virtuoso again. And you know, in a strange sort of way, all this stuff, this is in Bilbao, Spain. It's this grungy little town in Spain, terrible place actually. And then boing, they have this beautiful museum. And everybody goes to Bilbao and they spend all their money in Bilbao just because they want to see this Frank Gehry Museum. And just like the Guggenheim here in New York, it's a virtuoso extreme, it's the art of extremes, pulling and pushing and making the materials do things that they'd never done before. Just like Louis Armstrong, making that trumpet do stuff that it had never done before. Liszt making a piano make sounds that it had never made before. Turner making paint do things that it had never, ever been able to do before. Effects that suddenly take you... Here, let's go to the next slide, because the next slide's even weirder. I've been there, by the way. I'll give you... That's Rem Koolhaas. It's okay, we're getting ahead of ourselves a little bit. Let's go back to this one for just a second. I once, just to give you a funny anecdote, I once led a tour to Bilbao and other places in southern Europe, and I had to lead a tour in this museum. Now, as my wife will tell you, I'm always lost anyway. When we go on a trip or something, I'm completely lost. I had to lead a tour of 30 people from one part of this museum to another part. We got so lost. You can tell why. I mean, look at the shapes and the forms. You could get so lost in a building like that. And the reason why I keep this slide up for a little bit, too, is that these virtuosi,
they're, I don't want to call them the enemies of form, but they are the ones who go after form and try to destroy it in a way, to serve their own purposes and create their own new forms. The next one is, of course, Rem Koolhaas. And this is the store downtown that he did, the iPod store that he did down in Soho. He also did the Prada store down in Soho. He is, do you know this name, Rem Koolhaas? Have you heard of him at all?
No.
He's an architect, Dutch architect. I interviewed him. He has a building in Beijing?
Yes.
It's already done?
Yes.
Oh, okay. My wife informs me he has a building in Beijing. I will check that later on. He works in Amsterdam out of a fantastic office that he calls a sort of a collective office. I met him one time, and he did a book, by the way, which I heartily recommend to all of you. The name of this book was very, very clever anyway. SMLXL, small, medium, large, extra large. Rem Koolhaas. And it's, Koolhaas gives me the chance to talk to you a little bit about how this works in modern and postmodern terms as well. This guy is somebody who just doesn't know how to say no. He is an excessive artist. He's an artist who, kind of like an Armstrong or a Liszt and some of the others, he just adds and adds and adds and adds. If you look at this book, it's really, really big. You can use it as a doorstop to keep the door open in the summertime. And he just threw everything into this book. More photos, more design ideas, more drawings. Extra, extra, SMLXL, extra large, just more stuff. And very often I think that the virtuoso is an artist of not just extremes, but an artist of excess, an artist who doesn't know how to stop. And then the only way that I'm thinking of ending the book and bringing this backwards is to say, is it possible to be an artist of, rather than excess, but of restraint, of minimalism? Is it possible that in addition to a guy like Koolhaas, let's see what the next slide is, I've forgotten actually. Ah, well, here's a good example. He pretends. This is, of course, as you know, the I Ching pots that are made. These are virtuoso objects as well. This one I happen to love very much. You know the I Ching pots because of their color and their clay and their craftsmanship. When you meet someone who makes one of these I Ching pots, you have met a dafer, a master, someone who creates something of a special level, technical level in quality. As opposed to, for instance, a Rachmaninoff, this is a small thing of perfect proportions, made by somebody who has, I want to use the word dafer, master, right? Dafer is okay? Mastered the clay, mastered the form. So that, for instance, I would say the person who made this is as much a virtuoso as the person who made the museum in Bilbao. Are you following me on this? So one is the virtuoso of excess, and then you have the virtuoso of economy in a way. In fact, what I'm thinking of, and you know, I really am just thinking aloud tonight as I work on this book, one of the literary forms that I admire the most is the aphorism, the short saying. I mean, when I do this book, for instance, I want to have obviously a chapter on art and a chapter on architecture. Music, that's easy. You know, I'll have people like Armstrong and Chopin and Liszt, etc. I want to have a chapter on literature. Now, the reason for that, of course, is that I did my PhD in literature. So, you know, that's what I'm supposed to have a chapter on. But the other side of it is, I think the idea of literary virtuosi could be pretty interesting. On the one hand, you could have people who wrote long, long sentences in novels, like Proust. You know, he starts a sentence, and then about 5 years later, you get to the period. Or James Joyce, of course. And there are form breakers as well. Some poets, I'm thinking of Hart Crane. I love his work, the American poet Hart Crane, Walt Whitman. These are the excessive virtuosi. But how about a chapter on aphorisms as a literary form of the virtuoso? So that you get people, for instance, like Oscar Wilde, you know, and the wit of a guy who could, as he's walking into the customs office in New York when he first came to America, they said, "Have you anything to declare, Mr. Wilde?" He said, "I have nothing to declare but my genius." Now that's a virtuoso. I mean, and it's brilliant. You know, there's a brilliance to it. And of course, if I'm going to do that, what language, what literature in the world is better for economy than Chinese. You know, take all those fantastic four-character aphorisms of, for instance, Kongzi, Mengzi, Laozi, you know, Junzi Buqi, for instance. How did I do on my pronunciation? You say it.
Ask people if they understand.
Ani, do you understand me? Junzi Buqi. It's four characters, Confucius. A gentleman is not an instrument. I spent the whole month of January literally asking my wife, what does this mean? And thinking about, what is it? It's four characters, but it's a month, or it's years of commentary. Zheng Yong Judo, same thing. The Zheng Yong Judo, the Zheng Yong, you just call it. You know, one little aphorism, tons and tons of content, tons and tons of meaning. So that in a way, a virtuoso can be somebody who can do a sentence that goes on for page after page, but a virtuoso can also be somebody who can do it in four characters. What's the next slide? I've forgotten. Ah, well, of course. And now we get to the part that you all were waiting for probably the whole time, which is the calligraphy. And why calligraphy? Well, simply because, and I'm going to admit it straight out, I think of all the periods in art and of all the people who have picked up a brush and done something with a brush, the Chinese calligraphers of a particular period were the most vastly superior people of the brush that have ever existed. Never, and I showed you Vermeer, and I could have shown you Rembrandt, and certainly there was Leonardo and all the rest of them, and I'm now betraying the whole Western tradition, but I don't think anybody handled the brush the way Chinese calligraphers can. And in terms of virtuosity and technique, I think it's unsurpassed. I mean, this one, for instance, is imperial. This is the Southern Song Dynasty, style of Wang, oh, sorry about my pronunciation, Wang Xishi, but it's Gaozhong. And this is the emperor. I mean, can you imagine asking George W. Bush to write something? This is the emperor. The emperor could do this. And for me, of course, Lao Wai, I'm looking at gesture, I'm looking at strokes, I'm looking at the beauty of it as an incredibly ignorant, you know, not as a connoisseur, clearly, of calligraphy, but as someone who looks at a lot of painting and judges a lot of brush strokes. Let's look at the next one, for instance, because now you're going to get into the one I think is the greatest of them all, Mi Fu, also known as Mi Fei. These are from about the 11th century AD. These are just letters. These are just notes. I mean, jokingly, I could say it's like a note my wife leaves to me. You Yankees will go, you know, stop, you know, go and take the garbage out. I mean, there's these casual little letters. The content is almost the least important part of it. And yet, the balance of them. And, you know, I gave you that quote earlier about chaos shimmers through the veil of order. And now I'm going to just rely upon your understanding of Chinese calligraphy, because you did it when you were in school, and you did it when you were in school too. You knew the order that this has to follow, the balance, the grid. You know what I mean by grid? G-R-I-D. The grid would be verticals versus horizontals. Making sure when you learned it that everything was in the box. Making sure that the form was there. That's the veil of order. Then chaos shimmers through the veil of order. This is the part about Chinese calligraphy that I love. That suddenly, instead of just having the box and the grid, you've got the breaking of the grid a little bit. It goes against it. The way a great musician goes against the, you know, in music it's going to be, okay, E-R-Sansa, keep time. And then Chopin and Liszt would say, I'm so good, I'm not going to keep time. I'm going to just sort of go, let's give me a good example. I'm just going to, that's better, thanks. I'm just going to go out a little bit or come back in a little bit. One character will be larger, one character might be smaller. This is more Mi Fu as well. And to me, what I so admire of it is this sudden burst of freedom within a grid, within a form. Chaos shimmering through the veil of order. And, you know, I'm probably the person in this room who knows the least about Chinese calligraphy in certain ways, but when I write about this, one of the things I'm I'm sort of keying on, one of the things I'm focusing on is when Mifu takes the brush and makes the gesture and takes you off in a certain direction, the words disappear. The text sort of disappears. And that reminds me a little bit of Louis Armstrong or Liszt or Frank Gehry in this way. Louis Armstrong, you could say to him, okay, what are we going to play tonight, Louis? And, you see, and Armstrong probably, I wasn't there, but Armstrong probably said, you play whatever you want. I'm just going to do with it what I intend to do. For instance, how many times listening to jazz have you heard, let's see, I Got Rhythm by Gershwin? You know, I got rhythm. And then, but all of a sudden, you give it to a real good jazz man, and it's I Got Rhythm, and you say, ah, that's I Got Rhythm. I've heard that before. That's Gershwin. And then about 15 minutes later, once they've piled the variations on, once they've gone off and done their thing, once the drum guy has had his solo, once the bass has had his solo, and once the trumpeter's going, you listen, you say, where the heck is I Got Rhythm? I can't even hear the melody in there anymore. It's gone. These guys have taken off so wildly that it's gone. Same thing with the Gehry building in Bilbao. Where's the building? Where are the galleries? You know, where's the bathroom? Where's the pipe? Everything has disappeared behind this extravagant facade, this incredible gestural stuff that's going on outside the building. The text disappears in a piece of calligraphy like this. Let's look at the next one, because these are marvelous. Another Mi Fu. Not too fast. Let's go back, just for a second. I wish, stop with that one for a second, because this one's kind of interesting too. Now we're in a vertical format. This is Fushan. This is later. This comes from the 17th century. The approximate date is 1607. Of course, this is done on satin, which those of you who have done calligraphy will know that, whoa, satin, it takes the ink and the ink goes on you. The ink will go on paper anyway. The ink will spread. The ink will go, the control of it, but also the notion. Let me get a really, really good example. It's something like this, where you let a lot of ink pool there for a second, it will spread and it will sort of do its own thing. The way if I am at a piano and I get boom like this onto the chord and I've got my foot on the pedal, those notes, those strings will resonate for a while. And you could sort of control it, but you can't completely control it. It's Chance, a friend of mine, a wonderful artist named Charlie Clough. As he says, the rule of the studio is chance and choice. You have your choices. You make your mark. You have it under control. But chance is always there to take over. Anybody, by the way, I'm going to try to get to, maybe one time in the evening, I'll get to Noguchi and some of the other artists that I like to talk about. But anybody who's ever done ceramics or glass will understand chance and choice as well. You make your pot, you make your piece, you blow your glass, and then you put it in an oven or a kiln. And it's in there for a while, and the fire gets it. The glaze is on it, something might crack, the glaze might run, the glass might bend. The arts of fire are famous for adding chance to choice. Chance and choice in a piece like this. Let's go to the next one as well. This is sort of an old debate. I thought I'd just throw it in here, Tom, just to get people going. When I lived in China, which is back in the 80s, big, big debate was raging in those days about who were the better calligraphers, the Japanese or the Chinese. This is Japanese calligraphy, but very obviously taking off from the Chinese. One thing I love about this particular piece is a stroke that's called the Fei Bai, the flying white stroke. That notion that when you pull that brush across and you can let a little bit of paper come through, it's just like a flautist, somebody playing the flute, who lets a little breath come through and the note sound in between. It's a marvelous piece. Let's go to the next slide. Now Noguchi. And as you know, this is just a fascinating slide as far as Noguchi. Do you know about Noguchi? Isamu Noguchi? Ever heard of Noguchi? Half Japanese, half American. Yeah. His museum is out in Long Island City in Queens. May I make a recommendation to you? If you're totally stressed out as New Yorkers, as probably most of you are on a Friday afternoon, go on Saturday. I think Asia Society still has the little free bus. You go out to the Noguchi Museum, and there's a garden, and then there are his works. And they recently redid the Noguchi Museum. And here is that. First of all, that's one of the great moments in all of New York. But here is a fascinating, fascinating artist. Actually, we've got a video of Noguchi. Want to see Noguchi? Here's Noguchi. I'm just going to give you a quick video of Noguchi. His mom was an American, his dad was Japanese. And it's rather a sad story, actually. But wait, here comes... Uh-oh. This is up at Storm King, upstate. Hang on. I'll give you Noguchi. In a moment. That's Noguchi's work. No, it's not. Hang on. Here he is. This is Noguchi working.
It's very fundamental. It is within the ecological continuum of the world. I'm afraid that a lot of sculptures will become considered a kind of pollution, like tin cans are, because they really don't belong. Whereas rocks belong, I mean, more than you or I even. They know how to go just the way they're supposed to go, back into the earth.
This is a beautiful place called Storm King. That's a virtuoso too. That's Mark de Souffre. You can pop that out. I wanted you to see that tape for just a moment because I wanted to remind you that it was a guy like Noguchi, or almost any of the... Here's Noguchi's work here too. You must think about how they made their work. Go to the Noguchi Museum and you'll see a massive stone sculpture that has the most extraordinary surfaces and textures that he made, and I wanted you to watch him as he was doing it, that he made with power tools. He didn't do it the way Michelangelo did it all the time. He had power tools, he had drills, he had assistants, but boy, when he wanted an effect, he knew how to get an effect. Actually, I give you this one because I wanted you to see that he could also do calligraphy. Very, very, very sad story about Noguchi, by the way. His mom, as I said, was an American. His father, Japanese. They weren't married. Noguchi was born. Daddy was a poet, and a very good poet, by the way. Goes back to Japan. And then mommy made maybe a mistake. She went to Japan with Noguchi, the son. And when they got to Japan, Noguchi had another wife, other babies, and he said, I don't know this half and half one. Sorry. And then Noguchi comes back to America as a teenager, studies, and becomes truly one of the masters. And one of the reasons I bring up Noguchi, by the way, partly because I'm at Ari, but also because he learned his technique at the feet of a master. And that will be, I think, when I write this book, a very important part of it too. How did you master your technique? His master was Brancusi. He used to do, you know Brancusi, the Romanian sculptor? He used to create the base for Brancusi. And Brancusi would say, I want to have the base trued. I want the stone trued. In other words, I want this edge, I want it perfect. And he knew that he could tell Noguchi, because Noguchi had a particular, let's just call it a Japanese, or let's call it an Asian strength. He could follow the orders of the master, he could get it right, and he would do it and do it and do it until he got it. So he would learn to true the stone. And Brancusi had the greatest assistant he ever had in his life, making the base for his sculptures. Then after that, Noguchi does things like this. So we'll go on a little bit. I don't want to keep you too long tonight. Oh yeah, very good. Thank you very much. My wife reminds me that there's a fountain in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in the Asian, in the Japanese wing. This is Noguchi. Perfect example, actually. Black... it's called, the name of the rock is called basalt, black basalt, and the surface of the fountain is a perfectly still plane of water that comes to the edge and drops like this. And as it hits the rocks below, it makes the most exquisite sound. It is truly one of the greatest pieces in all of New York. So if you can't get out to Long Island City and you need to calm down, you go up to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and you see the work of Noguchi. And now comes my hero. I'm not going to call him my hero because you'll all think I'm crazy. I love the work of a Chinese artist named Zhang Da Qian. Ever heard of Zhang? Zhang Da Qian. Here's a bit of his calligraphy. Let's go to the next slide, though. This is my favorite part. Now, Zhang Da Qian, do you know about him? Know where he's from? Good. You know better than I do. Probably he's from Sichuan. Oh, yeah. Right? He changed his name. He changed everything. This is... the reason why you probably think I'm crazy to love this guy so much is that he was such a rascal. He was brilliant. He was a dasher. He was a master. He was a great calligrapher, as you just saw. He was a marvelous painter, but he was a total rascal. I mean, he was a bad boy, this Zhang Da Qian as well. I'll give you a little bit about his. He took the religious name Da Qian upon becoming a Buddhist monk. He was a monk and a rascal, right? And then after returning to the laity, in other words, he became a monk, and then he did not want to be a monk anymore, he called himself Dai Qian, true sure, or lay believer Dai Qian. At the age of 21, he studied under, and this is important, because this is where he got his craft. He studied under Zhang Zi and Li Zhu Qing, and I'm sure I blew those two names really badly, I apologize. He began, let's go to the next one, and then we're going to come back to this one. Ah, too bad. Now this is a late one. Let's go to the next one. This is supposedly his last painting, which was just in People's Daily, and that's a white on white. No, please go back. That's not Zhang Da Qian. Back. Maybe we'll go back a couple. That's a white painting. That's Zhang Da Qian's last painting. That's typical of his style. A wonderful use of color, by the way. And beautiful, beautiful calligraphy. This is one of the pieces that's up at the Metropolitan Museum. It's a little bit of out of focus, but it's not completely out of focus. Stop for a second on this one. Zhang Da Qian's watercolors and ink paintings are just amazingly brilliant examples of chaos shimmering through the veil of order. He would put the color down and let it run, and somehow or other, he would make a coherent landscape, or a lotus painting, or a blossom painting out of it, but with lots of freedom, with lots of gesture in it, because he was such a master. But the one that I think you might find interesting, and by the way, he traveled a lot, not just in China, but also in Latin America as well. He ended up in South America for a while. Let's go back a little bit, because this is the one that I really want people to get a laugh out of. I hope you'll enjoy this part. Next one, the one previous, this baby. Now this baby, this is in the collection of a wonderful collector who gave a lot of paintings to the Metropolitan Museum named C.C. Wang. And it was attributed not to Zhang Da Qian. This was supposedly a 9th century masterpiece of painting that was one of the highlights of the C.C. Wang collection, and the Met displayed it for many, many years, and they said the year was 906 A.D., And guess what, everybody? Guess what? Just a few years ago, I don't know if you remember this. Do you remember the colloquium they had at the Met? Anybody remember this part? I love stuff like this, but I mean, unfortunately, for some people, it meant losing face. Whoops. But for many, many people, it was riveting. This is a forgery. This is you know what I mean by a forgery? It's a fake. It's a fake. It looks like a 10th century painting. The paper seems like 10th century paper. The technique is that of many, many other 10th, 11th, and 12th century paintings that you'll see at the Met. I mean, I remember in the old days, you know, when my wife first came to the States, and we'd go up to the Met on Friday evenings, almost every Friday evening, I remember seeing this one, and it was in the gallery with the old paintings. And it was labeled 906 AD. And guess who did it? That rascal, Zhang Da Qian, he made such a good fake that generations of scholars thought it was real, including a very, very important connoisseur named C.C. Wang. He went for it. And they convened a whole colloquium, a whole seminar at the Metropolitan Museum of Art on this painting. They brought the experts in from Taipei, they brought the experts in from Beijing, they brought the experts in from Singapore, they brought them in from everywhere, from Japan, all the people from the Art Institute of Chicago, and they all sat there and they looked at this thing, and they looked, and they looked, and they tested the paper, and they tried the ink, and they said, it's such a good fake that we're really not sure. We really don't know. And then finally someone said, of course, the trick of something like this, of course, is saying, did he ever admit that he did it? Does anybody know whether he did it? And finally, because Zhang Da Qian is a 20th century painter, he didn't die that long ago, finally somebody came up and said, it's a fake. He's so good that he faked a great painting.
How did they find out?
I think it was the analysis eventually, the chemical analysis at Oxford of the ink. And they said this particular ink was not used in 906. This is a modern ink. And also somebody came forward and said he bragged about it. He bragged about it at one time. He said that he had done it. And of course, for the Met, you see, when something like this happens, and by the way, this happens to museums occasionally, the Rembrandt research project went around to different museums, they went to the Frick Museum and said, oh, by the way, the Polish writer, which is supposed to be by Rembrandt, this is not by Rembrandt, sorry. So what you thought was a $100 million painting is now, you know, a $100,000 painting or less. In other words, this happens quite a lot in the world of art. Things are reattributed. But what I find so fascinating, now we can go to the last painting. Sorry. There is no existing, it's in the style of, but there is no painting that he copied. In other words, he's so good, huh?
But he created that.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. You know what it would be like? It would be like somebody coming on stage at Carnegie Hall and saying, ladies and gentlemen, I have discovered a lost manuscript of Beethoven. And here, can you imagine? And here is Beethoven's last sonata that nobody has ever published and nobody has ever heard before. And you'd sit down, and it would take a pianist such as Alfred Brendel to pull this one off. First of all, you'd have to be able to play it. Second of all, you'd have to be able to compose it. And third, you'd have to get the critics and the others to go for it. And all of that would take virtuosity. It would take audacity. It would take, I mean, what I think is fascinating, and it's kind of fun to have this one of Zhang's up here, is that he must have been one of the bravest people I've ever met to think that he could get away with that, or to think that he could get away with this as well. And I wonder, Tom, if you don't mind, you know, I want to go through a few of the other slides, but one of the questions I would like to pose to you as my audience of intellectuals, of people who understand this as well as I ever will, probably better. I always thought that a guy like Zhang Da Qian, or even some of the calligraphers we looked at before, Mi Fei and others, there's almost something that's not quite Chinese about that. Or is there? In other words, it always astonished me that one of the best calligraphers of the 20th century, as you go around China, is Mao Zedong. And Mao's calligraphy is very wild. It's not straight. It's not orderly. It's not like what you would expect a military man to do. It's that wonderful running grass stuff. And I guess my question to you might be, maybe at the end of the lecture, is which one is the more Chinese way of doing something? To make calligraphy that is very straight and strict and box, or to do this wild stuff that, for instance, Zhang would do? Because, of course, it goes back to one aspect of the virtuoso that is maybe one of the most important aspects of it from a musician's point of view or from an athlete's point of view, too, which is the virtuoso is a soloist. You understand what I mean? The virtuoso goes solo. Louis Armstrong played with the band, but then he would come out. Actually, one of the best examples of this would be this one. More music, everybody. How do I make this play? Like this. Listen for the cello. There's a cello in there. And that is the instrument and that is the artistry of one of the great virtuosi of our time. And he's Chinese. What's his name? Yo-Yo Ma. That's Yo-Yo Ma. You listening? Now here comes just a question. I like to stimulate. Yo-Yo Ma will spend half a concert as the soloist. That was, for instance, the Vivaldi album that he did. I mean, let's put it this way. Yo-Yo Ma is unparalleled right now as the technician, technique, and the cello. No question. Yo-Yo Ma will spend the first half of the concert as the soloist in, for instance, the Dvorak or the Haydn concerto. So he's up front and center, and he's playing. And he's doing the Yo-Yo Ma show, you know, his eyes are closed, his mouth is open. And that's the soloist. And, you know, that's cool, because that's exactly what everybody paid for. You know, that's what you paid the big money for, the ticket for. That you want to see Yo-Yo Ma being Yo-Yo Ma. And he's being the soloist out there. Now, here's the part that I find fascinating about Yo-Yo Ma. The second half of the concert, sometimes in Chicago, sometimes in New York, sometimes at Cleveland, depends on the orchestra. If you look carefully in the cello section of the orchestra, who do you see? Yo-Yo Ma. In other words, instead of sitting up at the front, where everybody's attention is on him and the spotlight is on him, he goes back into the cello section, right next to the other cellists. You see him come in, shake hands, sit down, share a stand with them, and blend in and merge in. And do you know, I find that absolutely fascinating, because it means he can be the star or he can play in the ensemble. I'm an athlete. I play team sports. I love team sports. I play soccer and I play ice hockey. Last night I played hockey, right? In team sports, you pass to each other. I pass the puck to my teammate, he passes back to me. Basketball, you pass, you get it back. Soccer, you pass and you get it back. But every once in a while in a team sport, some guy will be so good that he'll just take the ball and go to the basket, take the puck. I mean, last night I was playing with a professional guy from the Islanders. All of a sudden, he was gone. Scored the goal. And we all just took our sticks and went like this. Bravo, bravo. I mean, it was like watching Yo-Yo Ma play the solo. But you know what happened? He broke the teamwork. He broke the game by doing that, by just taking off like that. Just as a soloist breaks the music. You ever watch the other players during a concerto? They just sort of sit there, roll their eyes. Or, you know, Sarah Chang is doing her thing. All the other violinists are going, oh God, when is this over, you know? Because they have nothing to play at that point. It's just the soloist showing off in a way. My question in a way comes all the way back to this. Yo-Yo Ma is a fascinating dual example of this. He could play in the ensemble, he could play in the team, but he can also show off and do things that other cellists can't do. Zhang Da Qian could imitate an old master so well that you didn't know it was a 20th century painting. Or he could do this. Totally original, completely Zhang Da Qian. Let's just go on quickly, because I think people probably want to discuss or ask questions. This idea of the virtuoso, next, translates very quickly into other art and other art forms. I could play you more music, but let's just do art for a second. This is an artist I knew pretty well. His name was Balthus. He only died a few years ago. He's one of the few artists. This is a painting called The Mountain, which is up at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. He's one of the few artists who will say to you that he's painting masterpieces. He lived in Paris at the same time as Picasso did in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s. And Picasso knew his work well. In fact, Picasso owned a painting of the same period as this. Picasso once said to Balthus, "You are the only other painter in Paris who can do sort of what I can do." And why? Well, because Balthus was a very great master of form and of the body. And he could paint just as Zhang Da Qian could. He could paint sort of old master paintings, except with 20th century subject matter. Let's go to the next one. This is a man named Cy Twombly, American painter. He uses a lot of color, obviously. He lets the paint drip and run. The reason I put this one up to a certain degree is it reminds me a lot of Zhang Da Qian's painting. Many people in the world will say, blah, that's a mess, it's chaos, it's no form, it doesn't hang together the way a painting does. And yet, every connoisseur, every collector, all the auction houses will agree. Cy Twombly, who's still alive, by the way, lives down south. Cy Twombly is one of the great American masters. He's a virtuoso of this running paint. Let's go to the next slide. Ah, this is a very dear friend of mine, and I brought him in because he casts his work in Beijing. His name is Tracy Henneberger. Remember Tracy? And this is bronze, and these are lychee. These are lychee, from the lychee fruit. You know lychee? I'm making you hungry, right? Lychee. He takes the pit, he makes, he take, hey, what are you doing? He takes the pit, and then he casts the whole thing, he puts them all together, and then he casts them in bronze. That's okay. You know, if you want to just go, we could go on if you want. Sorry. Slideshow. Okay. That's exciting. View show. And he casts them in bronze anyway. And what's kind of interesting about Tracy is that he will do... Oh, that's okay. Stop. He will do... We're gonna. No, that's okay. He will do the whole thing out of lychees cast in bronze. So he will take an old style, an old technique of sculpture, and then he will do this most outrageous things and cast them in bronze. This is a great way to review our notes. We'll get up to Tracy in a second. That's Balthus, that's Twombly, there's Tracy. Okay, stop, never mind. And then many other, you could put the lights up if you want. Many other artists, as you can imagine, will try to do something a little wild, a little extreme, a little different from other artists, sometimes using old techniques and sometimes using new techniques. So I don't know what the conclusion of my lecture is. The conclusion of my lecture is, thank goodness for Ari that lets me, you know, pursue a topic like this, see where it goes, try to find the examples of the virtuoso, incorporate people like Noguchi, Mi Fei, Zhang Da Qian, and many of the other calligraphers that I love so well, but put them in the context, shall we say, of other virtuosos from all around the world. And I'm afraid this has been a long lecture for some of you, a lot to absorb, but I'm looking forward to any questions or comments you might have. And thank you for coming. How about questions? How about comments? How about an answer to that question that I had, which is, which is more Chinese, to be a virtuoso or to stay within the lines of the form? Which is the more Chinese yo-yo ma? The yo-yo ma who's in the front of the orchestra and is the soloist, or the yo-yo ma who goes back to the cello section? What do you think?
Both.
Yeah, sure.
I guess that's him.
Yo-yo ma.
Right, you know, he must be doing this kind of thing, like, you know, play with other people for a long time.
Yes.
He get good enough with his technique, then he can be virtuoso.
That's right.
I think it's like at that calligraphy, you know, okay, you have to be good enough, or maybe you have to be famous, then you have freedom to do whatever thing you want to do.
That's
it. And you see, when I, suppose I was a kid,
yeah.
Okay, I go to write things, you know, Chinese character.
Yes.
I have to be right inside this group.
I thought so, yeah,
if,
sure.
If I don't do this, my father or my grandfather will